Today we're going to be dealing with a few questions that are part of my Anything Goes Friday. Does policy matter? Is it worth it to get into the weeds? This is sort of the Beto O'Rourke versus Elizabeth Warren question. Is it more about hopping on tables or more about coming up with policy papers? I'll offer my view. Also today, I want to deal with one of your questions, which is, who are these people? Understanding the right wing. We won't deal with every element of that, but we will get at least a little bit into the weeds on that question. Had a conservative caller yesterday that wanted to hear from, but I knew it was going to be more than a 30-second thing. Would invite you to call again today, 202-808-9925. Also, we'll be doing Watch Your Language today. And I'll be explaining that in just a moment. And some news. Brexit failed again. Not a hundo P chance of success for Brexit. Much less than a hundo P. And I suppose because it's one of the bigger stories in the world, I should talk about it a little bit. We'll talk about Stephen Moore. You know who that is? New appointee to the Fed? We should say something about that. And that'll connect with this question of understanding the right wing a little bit. Every great cause begins as a movement, becomes a business, and eventually degenerates into a racket. Eric Hoffer said that. Now, I don't agree with all of Hoffer's stuff. He wrote True Believer. Ronald Reagan gave him an award. He, in the wake of the rise of communist dictatorship in the Soviet Union and the recent fall of fascist dictatorship in Germany and Italy, he wrote True Believer about mass movements. He made a couple points that I think are worth us remembering and keeping in mind. A couple of things I think we might quibble with. I'll say my greatest disagreement with Hoffer. My greatest disagreement with Hoffer is that he acknowledges that there have been some good mass movements, spends a little bit of time on that, and lists some number, but then spends almost the entirety of the book talking about how mass movements are bad. I think that that is a little bit clumsy. I think he has been too roundly praised in the intellectual press, because I think instead of just calling them mass movements, he needed to come up with another word. He said, well, there's good ones and bad ones, but then he used one word and then mostly talked about how they were bad. And if I had just had to live through World War II and live through the rise of the Nazi Party, I suppose I wouldn't be thinking as much either about the civil rights movement or about the consumer rights movement or about the women's rights movement or the suffrage movement. But nonetheless, he has some stuff that's brilliant, it's important. One is this idea of the potential for causes to degenerate into a racket. And I want to talk about the right wing, both in its ideal desire, design, its objectives, what it might say that it is, and also remind people of the Hoffer, and Hoffer was part of the same society that that Friedrich Hayek, F.A. Hayek, was part of, that Milton Friedman was a part of. He did, he was not of that same ilk in every way, but how movements can degenerate. But also these reminders from Hoffer. Not quoting, paraphrasing. The new poor are the most likely source of converts for negative mass movements. They recall their former wealth with resentment and blame others for their current misfortunes. Examples include the mass evictions of the relatively prosperous tenants during the English Civil War of the 1600s, or the middle and working classes in Germany who passionately supported Hitler in the 1930s after suffering years of economic hardship. New poor. People who've lost some degree of their social position. Sound familiar? In Germany during the 1920s and 1930s, when communists and fascists were ostensibly bitter enemies, but in fact competed for many of the same type of angry, marginalized people. Nazi Adolf Hitler and communist Karl Radek, and I never met the man, I may be mispronouncing his name, all boasted of their prowess in converting their rivals. I've been thinking about the Overton window and the current debate and the calls we've had over the week saying, we aren't as divided as we think. And so much of the political apparatus, so much of the media apparatus is built to divide us, to offer heat rather than light. And I have a view, and our listeners have a view, and I believe very strongly that climate change isn't only half real, and that wealth disparities aren't only half a problem, and that same-sex marriage isn't only half moral. I have a view, but I don't think that our view should be that we try primarily to profit from dividing one another. And the lesson of history, of exploiting the newly weakened in order to join a negative movement, a potentially oppressive movement, and that you might even compete not merely based on the adjacency or similarity of your ideology or your policy program, but of your emotional appeal, and that could get us to embrace, and by us I just mean lots of human beings, to embrace destructive movements, is something we should keep in mind. And also this from Hoffer. Successful mass movements need not believe in a God, but they must believe in a devil. Hatred unifies the true believers. And now I am quoting, the ideal devil is a foreigner, attributed with nearly supernatural powers of evil. Does that sound familiar? As we try to shed ourselves, or at least weaken our own sexism, our own misogyny, our own racism, our own xenophobia, our own ethnocentrism, let's make sure also that we understand people with different viewpoints. That means we have to find the midpoint. We have to understand that our purpose is to solve problems, to make democracy a little bit better rather than a lot worse, and that we are, and if we are listening to going to purpose, our purpose is not to destroy, our purpose is not to divide, but our purpose is a better democracy. We'll be back.